And again, as we stated, an hour after Margaret's interview, it was announced that Israel was launching a ground invasion. More now on the escalation of the conflict. Khalil Jahshan is the executive director of the Arab Center of Washington. It's a nonprofit organization that seeks to foster deeper understanding of Arab culture. And Natan Sachs is a fellow at the Saban Center for Middle East Policy at the Brookings Institution. He focuses on Israeli foreign and domestic politics and the Arab-Israeli conflict. And we welcome you both. Natan Sachs, what can Israel accomplish with a ground invasion that it couldn't accomplish by sending hundreds of missiles into Gaza?
Well, the main objective right now is to go after these tunnels, the tunnels between the Gaza Strip and Israel. Egypt has acted very forcefully against the tunnels between Sinai and Gaza, but they're tunnels that go underneath the border to Israel, and several attacks have come out of there, especially most famously an attack that abducted Gilad Shalit, a prisoner, an Israeli soldier, and then there was 5 years of his imprisonment, a trauma for Israel in a sense. They're trying to go after these tunnels on the Gazan side.
But what is it? Have they not been able to? I mean, help us understand, what is it about these tunnels, what's going on inside them or around them, that Israel can't accomplish with missiles?
Well, there's a lot that you can't do from the air. They know a bit about where they are. In fact, this operation a week and a half ago began really with a targeting of a specific tunnel, but then just today they found another one. And they suspect, they expect that there are many more on the Gazan side. But going in with the ground troops, they hope that they're able to uncover this and to stop them from the Gazan side.
Khalil Jahshan, what does Hamas use the tunnels for?
Basically, the tunnels are part and parcel of the military strategy of Hamas. They haven't been really using them like daily. I think there is a big exaggeration on the part of the Israelis. As we just heard, Natan mentioned the incident that took place about 6 years ago. That's 6 years ago. You know, we've had three wars in Gaza since then. The Israelis know where these tunnels are. They can do like Egypt did. They can come in and block them from their side if they need. They have that intelligence. They have that spatial intelligence from outer space. They can tell where these tunnels are and how deep they are and where do they lead. I think the Israelis basically decided to expand their strategy in Gaza by doing this incursion. I don't think it's an invasion of Gaza yet. I think the Israelis are using this gradual, if you will, escalation strategy, and they are using the tunnels as an excuse. And they're not going to achieve their political objectives.
Let me ask you to back up. When you say you don't think it's an invasion yet, what are you saying is going on here?
What's going on basically is a limited incursion, I think, into the border area between Gaza and Israel to destroy these tunnels. These tunnels are only few meters inside Gaza and few meters inside Israel. I don't think you are going to see Israeli troops yet, unless the defense of Gaza collapses or unless there is an additional escalation. But right now, it seems to me that this incursion has a limited, if you will, geographic or spatial aspect to it. It's not, you're not going to see Israeli troops going all the way to Rafah or all the way to Khan Yunis or all the way to Gaza City.
Is that what you see going on, Natan Sachs?
I worry that it can be more expensive than that. There's a chance that the Israelis are going to try to go after some of the launch sites of these rockets, in particular in the northern part of the Gaza Strip. And they also may try to sever the Gaza Strip to prevent Gaza or the Hamas from movement.
And this is in heavily occupied at an urban area.
It
is
the
right?
Tragedy of this war. And really, we should all have a lot of sympathy for the people of Gaza and of Israel. But the tragedy of this war is that it's in a very populated area, and it's completely avoidable. We should not be in this stage at all. The ceasefire 3 days ago that the Egyptians suggested should have taken hold. Hamas could have just held its fire and we would not be fighting today at all.
How do you answer that?
Well, basically, I mean, you are correct in indicating, first of all, the limited space involved in this conflict. I mean, Gaza, for all practical purposes, the whole strip is twice the area of Washington, D.C. And when you think of the strongest air force in the region, you're talking about the fifth or sixth strongest country in the world. Militarily, when you think of the Israeli Navy bombing from the other side. So you're talking about a very, very small piece of real estate, the bulk of which is desert, by the way. The inhabited part is even smaller than D.C. So it doesn't make sense to kind of seek a military solution to what essentially is a political problem. And that's what Israel needs to focus on.
In the longer term, absolutely. There's only a political solution to this, and the sides should get back to the table. The problem is that Hamas is not involved in this, not involved in the political solution. We should have sympathy for the people of Gaza, and I say this completely genuinely, mm-hmm. and of Israel and the West Bank. But Hamas is not the people of Gaza. Hamas is the one that's bringing this war upon them.
But Natan, Hamas is not involved because you're not allowing it to get involved. I mean, Hamas is being excluded from the process. Hamas is being excluded from any type of negotiations. It's being described as a terrorist organization, and it is laid under siege in Gaza. And this is the reason why the ceasefire, unfortunately, collapsed, because Hamas was excluded from the process. This is the biggest sin committed by our Secretary of State and by Mr. Netanyahu by simply channeling this whole process to Egypt, which is not ready to proceed because of lack of relationship with the Palestinians. And Hamas is out of the picture. When the process started in Qatar, well, there was an earlier version of this.
You're describing a division on the Arab side here, which has made finding a solution much more difficult.
Much harder. In the past, you had Egypt to negotiate between the sides, and today the Egyptians and the Muslim Brotherhood and Hamas, the Muslim Brotherhood in Palestine, have very bad relations. And even Egypt today came out with a very unusual declaration blaming Hamas for this round of fight.
Where do you see this headed, Khalil Jahshan? Because people are going to continue to ask, why isn't Hamas prepared to accept a truce?
In the long future, long term, I can see this basically staying this way. Every couple of years, we're going to have another, you know, conflict between some Palestinians, whether Hamas or somebody else, in the future, and the state of Israel, unless there is peace. So in the future, long term, I would say peace is the answer. Without solving the Palestinian problem, Israel will continue to have these wars. Some in Israel feel that this is affordable. I don't think so.
But in the meantime, right now we have a hot war that is resumed.
The immediate need is simply for a ceasefire. And that's why the Egyptian attempt was so important. That's why I do see so much blame on Hamas. In the longer term, I agree completely with Khalil. The only option is a peace process, a genuine peace process that tries to reach a two-state solution despite all the difficulties that we've seen. But in the immediate sense, what we're seeing right now, the tragedy that we're seeing right now, is preventable and needs to stop.
Natan Sachs, Khalil Jahshan, we thank you both.
Thank you very
much. Thank you.